you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
I want to share a message about life today. I want to share something uplifting. I want to get us to think about the whole message of Easter. But, you know, there's various people that get stuck at the cross, never move on to the tomb. And there's people who never spend enough time at the cross and get to the tomb too quickly. Let's be people that are balanced. And let's remember both this weekend. Someone asked Joseph of Arimathea, whose tomb Jesus was placed in, "That was a great tomb. Why did you give it to someone else to be buried in?" "Oh," said Joseph, "he only needed it for a weekend." Lee Strobel said, "It was the worst news I could get as an atheist. My agnostic wife had decided to become a Christian. Two words shot through my mind. The first was an expletive, and the second was divorce. I thought she was going to turn into a self-righteous holy roller, but over the following months, I was intrigued by the positive changes in her character and values. Finally, I decided to take my journalism and legal training. I was legal editor of the Chicago Tribune, and systematically investigate whether there was any credibility to Christianity. Maybe I figured I could extricate her from this cult. I quickly determined that the alleged resurrection of Jesus was the key. Anyone can claim to be divine, but if Jesus backed up his claim by returning from the dead, then that was awfully good evidence he was telling the truth. For nearly 2 years, I explored the minutiae of the historical data on whether Easter was myth or reality. I didn't merely accept the New Testament at face value. I was determined only to consider facts that were well supported historically. As my investigation unfolded, my atheism began to buckle. Was Jesus really executed? In my opinion, the evidence is so strong that even atheist historian Gerd Lerdman said his death by crucifixion was indisputable. Was Jesus' tomb empty? Scholar William Lane Craig points out that its location was known to Christians and non-Christians alike. So if it hadn't been empty, it would have been impossible for a movement founded on the resurrection to have exploded into existence in the same city where Jesus had been publicly executed just a few weeks before. Besides, even Jesus' opponents implicitly admitted the tomb was vacant by saying that his body had been stolen. But nobody had a motive for taking the body, especially the disciples. They wouldn't have been willing to die brutal martyrs' deaths if they knew this was all a lie. Did anyone see Jesus alive again? I identified at least 8 ancient sources, both inside and outside the New Testament, that in my view confirm the apostles' conviction that they encountered and the resurrected Christ. Repeatedly, these sources stood strong when I tried to discredit them. Could these encounters then have been hallucinations? No way, experts tell me. Hallucinations only occur in individuals' brains like dreams. Yet, according to the Bible, Jesus appeared to groups of people on 3 different occasions, including 500 at once. Was this some sort of vision, perhaps prompted by the apostles' grief over their leader's execution? This wouldn't explain the dramatic conversion of Saul, an opponent of Christians, or James, the once skeptical half-brother of Jesus. Neither was primed for a vision, yet each one saw the risen Jesus and later died proclaiming he had appeared to him. Besides, if these were visions, the body would still have been in the tomb. So was the resurrection the recasting of ensuing mythology, akin to the fanciful tales of Osiris or Mithras? If you want to see a historian laugh out loud, bring up that kind of pop culture nonsense. No, Lee says, one by one, my objections evaporated. I read books by skeptics, but their counter-arguments crumbled under the weight of the historical data. No wonder atheists so often come up short in scholarly debates over the resurrection, because in the end, after I thoroughly investigated the matter, I reached an unexpected conclusion. It would actually take more faith to maintain my atheism than to become a follower of Jesus. And that's why I'm now celebrating my 30th Easter as a Christian. Not because of wishful thinking, the fear of death, or the need for a psychological crutch, but because of the facts. So we're looking at the issue of evidence today. We live in a world that increasingly wants proof. Evidence to support what we're trying to prove is real or true. It's the same as it was 2,000 years ago. People wanted proof. And today I want to focus on the different reactions of those who came looking for proof of life after the crucifixion of Jesus. Everyone reacts to evidence in different ways. Some need to see, some need to hear, and some need to touch. It's interesting how they all reacted on Resurrection Sunday. Listen to this. John 20, verse 1. Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. And she ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. And she said, "They have taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." Look at that. Mary immediately concluded he'd gone somehow, taken by someone, and put somewhere. It's interesting because at this point, Mary hadn't gone in. But we need to take note of something significant that I don't know whether I've noticed this before. It says she came to the tomb while it was still dark. So even if she had gone in, she potentially would not have been able to see. Can I just clarify something we need to realize, though? The stone wasn't rolled away to let Jesus out, but to let others in. He didn't need it rolled away. As we're going to find out in a few moments, he had this amazing way with his resurrection body of walking through walls. The tomb was opened to let us in, to give us a clue and show us proof of life. It says in verse 3, Peter and the other disciple started out for the tomb, and they were both running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He stooped and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed the linen wrappings lying there, and while the cloth that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings, then the disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For until then, they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead. And then they went home. Goes on to say in verse 11, Mary was standing outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she stooped and looked in. And she saw two white-robed angels, one sitting at the head and one sitting at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" the angels asked her. "Because they've taken away my Lord," she replied, "and I don't know where they have put him." She turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked her. "Who are you looking for?" She thought he was the gardener. "Sir," she said, "if you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him." Even though Mary now went in, she still chose to see an empty tomb because she saw the stone rolled away rather than the evidence within it. She had an encounter with two angels who had dialogue with her. Surely it must have dawned on her this was not an everyday occurrence. Well, maybe for Mary it was, but I don't know about you, but that would not be an everyday occurrence for me. I would be thinking, hang on, something's happening here. Something's up. Something's occurring. But here was the deal. What Mary saw determined what she could see and what she could hear. In verse 16, "Mary," Jesus said, and she turned to him and cried out, "Rabboni," which in Hebrew means teacher. "Don't cling to me," Jesus said, "for I haven't yet ascended to the Father, but go find my brothers and tell them I am ascending to my Father and your Father and to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene found the disciples and told them, "I have seen the Lord," and then she gave them his message. So Mary only responded to the evidence when she recognized his voice as he said her name, which for her was proof of life. Initially, she couldn't hear it because of what she was looking at and what she was focused on. Let's read on. Verse 19, "That Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. 'Peace be with you,' he said." So the very same voice that Mary heard was not recognized by the disciples, even though he spoke to them in only the way that Jesus could. Who else walks through a wall and says, "Peace be with you"? It says in verse 20, "As he spoke, he showed them the wounds in his hand and his side, and they were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. Again he said, 'Peace be with you. And as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you.' And then he breathed on them and said, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone else's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven.'" So these guys had to see the evidence. And it wasn't until he showed them his hands and his feet that they believed, for which for them was proof of life. It wasn't in the hearing. It wasn't even in the seeing, but in the showing that they believed. However, for one disciple, it had to go beyond all of that. It says in verse 24, one of the 12 disciples, Thomas, nicknamed the twin, nicknamed something else as well, was not with the others when Jesus came. And they told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he replied, "I won't believe," in a Victor Meldrew voice, "I don't believe it unless I see the nail wounds in his hands, put my fingers into them, and place my hand into the wound in his side." 8 days later, the disciples were together again, and this time Thomas was with them, and the doors were locked, but Jesus did another appearing act through the wall and said, "Peace be with you." I want you to see something else I guess I'd not really homed in on before, yet I've preached on this for 24 years. Thomas went through 8 days of unbelief, all because of the demands he placed for evidence. Look at his attitude. "I won't believe unless I see, I put, and I place." Talk about a set of demands. "I won't believe," not that I can't believe, I just won't believe, like I'm adamant, "I won't believe unless I see, I put, and I place." Jesus appeared by walking through a wall, and it still wasn't enough evidence for Thomas to see. Jesus spoke out of a risen body, and it still wasn't enough evidence for Thomas to hear. Some people are hard work. It says in verse 27, then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and look at my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side and don't be faithless any longer. Believe. My Lord and my God, Thomas exclaimed. And then Jesus told him, you believe because you've seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing me. Thomas wasn't content with just seeing and hearing. He wanted to touch Jesus. It was only when he touched the scarred hands and the wounded side that for him was proof of life. Wasn't in the hearing, seeing, or showing, but in the touching that he believed. That's why he got his nickname, Doubting Thomas. Now, some would see that as a negative, but not all doubt is negative. Let me explain. It's all to do with where it leads. If doubt leads to questions, if questions lead to answers, and if answers lead to belief, then doubting has done a good work. Doubt can lead to certainty, but it depends where it stops off on the way. However, if doubt leads to stubbornness and stubbornness becomes a lifestyle, then doubt is negative and harms faith. I got good news about Thomas. For Thomas, doubting was a reaction. It was not a repetition. In other words, it didn't become a habit or a lifestyle for him. Doubt should always be a temporary condition and never a permanent fixture. Doubt is one foot lifted, poised to step forward or backwards, but there is no motion until the foot comes down. It's only when the foot is down that the foot is down. See, in life, we have to stay in motion. Keep moving on by putting one foot down and taking a step forward. Too many people live a life because they live a life of doubt because they get stuck on a question and stop moving toward. How many people do that? Get stuck in life because why? They live a life of doubt because they got stuck on a question and stop moving towards the answer. There's always an answer. We just got to keep moving towards it. We will only come out believing proof if we go in looking for evidence and searching for clues. Oh, how our current position really does determine our present perspective. It's all to do with where we're positioned, how we're focused, and what we perceive. What we focus on determines what we believe in. Both these guys had equal opportunities to see the clue, but only one saw it. Two people can look at the same thing. One can see negatives, one can see positives. One can see obstacles, one can see opportunities. One can see problems, one can see possibilities. That's proof that what we choose to perceive determines how we choose to believe and who we choose to become. Let me put it in a shorter sentence. What we perceive is how we believe who we become. Is something I saw. Jesus only appeared to believers. He didn't appear to Pilate. He didn't appear to Herod. He didn't appear to the leading priests or elders. Do you know why I think that was? Because he didn't rise for effect. He has a plan for your life, and it's not based on what you've done or what you do, but on what he did. And 2,000 years ago, when he died on that cross, he came back to life 3 days later, and he did it all for you.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.